Sydney's Nouf Al Marwaai, who is the first yoga instructor in Saudi Arabia. She played a crucial role, instrumental role in making sure that yoga gets legal in Saudi Arabia. And she had a lot of fans, whether it's Saudi Arabia or India. What brings you here in India?
What brings me in India is a lot, as you mentioned, the yoga and Ayurveda. But over time, I grew friendships, I have families here, I have work. So my connection with India is much more than just coming to study yoga or Ayurveda.
But your main connection is yoga. You came a decade ago, and since then you have been coming almost on a yearly basis, on an annual basis. So how has yoga changed your life?
Yoga changed my life in so many aspects. As I mentioned always, that I came to know about yoga because of my health issues and because I was diagnosed with an autoimmune disease. But yoga changed more than my vitality or my health on the physical level. Yoga affected me in a very positive way, mentally and emotionally as well. I can say in so many aspects.
So it changed you in a lot of aspects, but why yoga? I mean, you're from Saudi Arabia, and if someone thinks about yoga in Saudi Arabia before you made it legal, it's like, it's not normal, many would say, but you made sure it becomes normal. So how did you choose yoga, and now it's of course legal?
As I also mention always in media, that my dad brought martial arts to Saudi Arabia, and my dad was working for security forces under Interior Ministry, Saudi Interior Ministry, and he was sent by the late Interior Minister Prince Nayef, seeing his physical ability and strength. He sent him to study martial arts in Japan to bring it with self-defense to the Saudi military sector. And my dad came across yoga, so he brought a book with him. The first yoga book I saw in 1990. I was 10 years old, and it was not easy to follow. It was a translated book for Iyengar father, and it was not really easy to follow. But by the time I was so interested to know more about yoga, looking at the asanas pictures, I felt so interested in trying these positions. And I got a book in 1998. There was a book I found in a Saudi bookstore, and it was for some foreigner publisher, and I used that book. I actually started with three asanas. I was so sick that time. I had joints pain, physical pain, and I could only do the three asanas, what we call in English cat and bridge and butterfly. Mm-hmm. And gradually I started progressing in my asanas.
Mm-hmm. But just explain how your journey from making yoga, which of course was once illegal, to making it legal in a conservative country like Saudi Arabia.
Yoga was not officially illegal, but it was not recognized. It was not legalized or classified, not in Ministry of Health system, not under Sports Authority. And the journey was not easy, because also that time of Saudi Arabia, women's sports were not officially recognized. And speaking of this, I must mention that Saudi Arabia, after a certain date, which is, as our Crown Prince always mentions, 1979, started moving more toward a more strict and conservative because of the Muslim Brotherhood movement. So women's sports were not allowed in schools and in public. So it was not easy for me first to approach for a sport, then to approach for yoga. So both were very difficult. I tried to open for centers and studios, and also did not find the legal structure or the classification that this should fall under. And then I started my journey in trying to approach certain authorities, trying to do something. And finally in 2017 it happened.
It finally happened. So what was your first reaction when you got this news that now you can go, now Nouf can go in Saudi Arabia? And of course,
I actually worked for it. I met Princess Rima. So one of the biggest changes happened in 2016 in Saudi Arabia, that the government started talking about women's sports, and Princess Rima bint Bandar Al Saud was selected to be the deputy of the General Sports Authority. And I met her in early in 2017 in February, as well as other women sports leaders who started a certain sports in Saudi Arabia and actually led a participation or training or practice for it, or even a campaign. And I spoke to her about yoga. We discussed yoga, and she was very supportive and also knowledgeable about yoga. And we took it from there. I've submitted. I get the best support from Princess Rima. Now she is the president of the Community Sports Federations. And I'll be very honest with you, without her existence in Sports Authority, maybe it would have not happened this easy. Her team is very supportive. It is very easy to talk to them, to discuss with them, to set standards, to work on projects regarding women's sports. So the change is very positive in this, and that's how I was able to do this after 15 years of trying.
But do you think that the reforms also helped in a sense get yoga legalized in a early way? Because maybe legalizing yoga maybe 10 years ago would have been much more difficult, and it's under the present reforms in Saudi Arabia yoga got legalized and it's okay to practice it now.
Definitely. The reforms are actually touching a lot of areas in the Saudi life and Saudi society, and mainly empowering women, because they are really looking into empowering women in every aspect, including wellness and health, including mental, psychological, physical health. The reforms are fast, actually, and we're very excited about it, especially in the sports sector. And when I say sport, I mean every sport. Sometimes people say yoga is not just a sport. Why are you calling it a sport? It's not proper. But scientifically, if you look at yoga increases and improves your pulmonary function, helps in metabolic rate issues, improves weight loss. It is a sport, but it is actually the best wellness sport. And we're really happy about that, and we're excited. It's not only in sports, it's in women education, women employment, women driving, women going out, owning their own business and being models for many things in Saudi Arabia.
So where all yoga is being practiced today in the kingdom? I mean, locations, is it practiced in major cities?
No, I can easily tell you that in every city in Saudi Arabia now, at least there is one teacher. So in Arab Yoga Foundation, we are a very big community, and we have more than 500 teachers around the kingdom. So because I started in Jeddah, the intensity of yoga practice is in Jeddah, but I also have students in Riyadh, a lot of students in Riyadh, and they're teaching. Some of them have their own centers in Shirgiya, Dammam, Kubar, in Mecca and Medina. In Yanbur, there are yoga teachers. At least in small cities now, there is one yoga teacher. So I have two teachers in Taif, which is an impressive thing, because these areas like Taif and Yanbur are considered to be small cities, and they're very conservative. And if women and men are interested in yoga, then there is a real change happens in people's thinking about wellness and health.
So there is a yoga practitioner in Makkah and Medina. They do yoga there also.
They do yoga, and they do understand that yoga is a sport. There is no connection between religion and actually hurting their belief by practicing yoga.
I was coming to that point, that there is a certain segment who believes that yoga and Islam are not compatible. What would you like to say to those people?
I'll be very honest with you. This idea did not originate in Saudi Arabia. It came to Saudi Arabia from people who might come from different Asian countries with a background of Hinduism and Buddhism. Martial arts come from a Buddhist background, but nobody can deny the fact that martial arts is a very important sport and an art, actually. Given the fact that yoga originates in India, doesn't make it 100% Hindu, because when I myself went to study yoga, none of the teachers forced any mantras, any beliefs in me. They respected every belief. We had other Christians in the also groups studying with us, and some of them were concerned about different things. So the teachers told them, it's up to you. We're teaching you the practice of a lifestyle for health. We're not teaching you anything that contradicts with your belief. Nobody forced anything on anybody. And I'll be very honest with you. Looking at yoga, for example, if I go to study yoga in Rishikesh, I'll go study mainly from different Hindu teachers. In Saudi Arabia, we are as religious as Hindus that we are studying with. If you start any conference in Saudi Arabia, you come to any conference or seminar, we start with reading something from Quran. Before we sit to eat our food, there is a dua. We say something for starting our food. Even before going to the restroom, we say some dua. And the same with yoga. People sit to practice their own practice. They will start with their own prayer or mantra, asking God to give them the health and the harmony and the benefit of that knowledge. We also have du'as before we study, that we ask God to give us the benefit of that knowledge and help us to use it in a good way. So I think everyone's belief is their own personal choice. And at the end of the day, learning something like yoga or karate or martial arts with a background of a different religion does not actually remove the fact that that these arts are very old and very beneficial for health, mental well-being as well.
So you dismiss those people who say that yoga and Islam is not compatible and Muslims can practice yoga.
They definitely can practice yoga, and there is a lot of Saudis who studied in Saudi school, who learned enough Quran and learned enough of their religion from Saudi Arabia itself, from Mecca, the origin of this religion, and they have no problem with it, because there is nothing says in yoga, when you perform this asanas you have to worship this, or when you do this you have to do that. They take it completely as a fitness and health and well-being practice, and they take it completely as an integrative way of life. And nobody can deny the facts. If you look at physiotherapy, for example, if you go for a back pain, or if you go for a rehabilitation session after an accident, it is the same what we do with range of motion from Sukshma Vayama. We do these things in physiotherapy and we do them in yoga. And yoga is more than 5,000 years old. But physiotherapy is so new.
The fact that yoga has been practiced in Mecca sends a message to everyone. I mean,
exactly.
It's the holiest place in Islam and it's being practiced there. But since you're practicing yoga, is there any other member of your family or your friends who also got interested and is practicing?
Yes, definitely. My sister is practicing yoga. My mom, she passed away 2 years ago. She used to practice yoga. My dad never objected. My dad works for government, and if there is anything that goes against, he would have stopped me himself, not encouraged me to look into it and how to understand what is suitable and what is not suitable, and nobody had objections. My cousin is certified by me. She learned under me, and she's teaching in Riyadh now. So I don't think there are a lot of also Indians studied with us in Saudi Arabia from different beliefs, be it Christians, Hindus, Muslims.
There's an extremist population in every country. Have you ever felt threatened, or someone threatened you, that the fact that you are practicing yoga? I mean, there must be, I mean, incidences, I believe.
Yes, not from Saudi Arabia, but yes, messages. On social media, emails, sometimes they go to our page and they write things. But these were not from Saudi Arabia. They were not from Saudi Arabia or Arabs. They were more from Asian countries.
More from Asian countries.
Yes.
Okay.
And that's why even Saudi students get surprised. Saudi yoga practitioners get surprised. Like, we in Saudi Arabia study Quran, study Hadith, study the tafsir or translation on Quran and the religion in schools on daily basis. Mm-hmm. We would have at least two classes a day in religion, in Islam. So if Saudis can understand what contradicts with their religion and what not, I think that is a clear example that yoga does not at all contradicts with the belief of the person.
Well, coming back to popularity of yoga in Saudi Arabia, so who, which segment of the population, the women or the men, are more eager or more happy to adopt yoga as a lifestyle?
It was more women years ago, but since the last 5 years we see more men are interested in yoga, and there are a lot of certified Saudi men yoga teachers, and they're actively teaching yoga either beside what they are doing as a sport or as a job, or they're full-time yoga teachers only in their own studios.
Ma'am, you come from Saudi Arabia, a country which of course is known for Islam because Makkah and Medina are there. What do you think about the current entire this debate which is going on Islam, and there is this divide between Islam versus the rest which is going on. What do you have to say on that?
I would say that on daily basis, on daily life in Saudi Arabia, we don't discuss this thing as normal people. Let's talk about normal youth. We are not very concerned. We have a lot of friends from different beliefs and religions, and we respect. Now, there is an extremism movement that is going on, as you mentioned, in every country. But I don't see the common youth now are really interested in this. So I think it is what's happening with the extremism and the Muslim Brotherhood movement that is actually brainwashing individuals and affecting this. But if you come to Saudi Arabia, you will be surprised at the amount of youth who are very open, respect our religion and beliefs. Even they are very good practitioners of their own belief, but at the same time, they're very open-minded, they're very educated, and they respect different beliefs.
Mm. So you're basically saying that there are certain extremist element, a minority which is giving bad name.
Exactly. And in Arab Yoga Foundation, for example, we are a very big community. We have different people from different nationalities. We have Christians, as I mentioned, Muslims, Hindus, and they're all friends. And now the yoga day is coming. They're working together, volunteering in the yoga day. They're from different beliefs, and nobody discusses belief. Nobody sits and say your belief is less than my belief or my belief is right. These discussions does not go on, at least among youth. We have so many nationalities in Saudi Arabia. And it'll be now Indian youth and Saudi youth are getting closer. We have a lot of Indian friends from different beliefs, and I don't see Saudis harassing them for their own beliefs. They respect and they discuss. They sit and they discuss what is in each belief, and they try to find similarities, and that's it.
Mm-hmm. You're a Saudi, and India, of course, has given yoga to the world. How do you see India's position globally as a country who has culturally given a lot, including yoga?
I'll be very honest with you that I'm very impressed that India in the last 4 years globally gained a lot of importance, and promoting also yoga as its cultural thing brought a lot of focus on India itself. As a foreigner, I'm speaking, I've been coming to India since 10 years and I've been hearing about India's image in my own country. The India's foreign policy or the image nowadays is really looked up at outside, especially in Saudi Arabia. Now, Saudis are really interested in Indian culture. They're very interested in yoga. They come to India regularly. People are interested in the Indian kurtas and dresses, Indian food, learning more about India. And it is an impressive thing, actually.
Now I'll end my interview with a message. What message would you like to give to our viewers from across the world on Yoga Day, the fourth International Yoga Day?
I would say yoga is a very important practice for health. Whether you practice it as a lifestyle or as an integrative therapy or as a sport, it will give you that benefit. Learning the concept of yoga in physical level and theoretical level as well gives you a lot to improve your mental health, your emotional health, your physical health, and also your social health. And it is a very important thing that is needed nowadays with our youth. Especially the kids who are now into electronics and games and not taking care of their health. Yoga is not an expensive sport. It does not need anything. It just needs a mat or a towel and yourself to stand there and practice it. You can do it in a flight. You can do it in an office. You can do it at home. You can even do it in 1 into 2 meters space. So I think it's a very important tool to be taught, to be used, to be carried with you whenever you go, whenever you need it.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you so much. And yoga is India's gift to the world, and you have adopted it and told to the world that how important is it. And you're a shining example of how yoga can also help and cure people from various illnesses. But thank you so much for talking to WION on the various troubles you face and, of course, challenges, and finally coming out successfully. And thanks so much
Thank
for
you.
Being with us. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you.